2 Kings chapter 2, verse 6, and it says, "And Elijah said unto him, Tarry, I pray thee, here." Somebody say, "Stay here. For the Lord has sent me to Jordan." And he said, "As the Lord liveth, and as thy soul liveth, I will not leave thee." What he was saying was, you are more important than the destiny. I realize God's called you to Jordan, but I feel like God's called me to you. And they two went on, and 50 men of the sun, let's just skip that part, verse 8, and Elijah took his mantle, wrapped it together, and smote the waters. They were divided hither and thither, so that they too went over on dry ground. How many of you would like to have seen that? That happened in our modern time under Apostle Billy Cole. Going back preaching in the jungle, impossible to get across to preach to them. And he said, "Lord, if you can do it for Elijah." And he took his coat off and smote the water, and it did the same for them. He's a God right now as he's ever been. How many believe that? Praise the name of the Lord. I feel to stop for a moment. I'm going to finish this text, but I just feel a need for us to pray together. My district superintendent is in a very, very serious situation with his heart. Brother Norman Pasley, and on a heart transplant list. He's young. To be where he is, they had to put an artificial heart. There's been some complications. And I just feel like I need to interrupt this moment to pray for him. Would you do that with me? Let's pray that God would heal him. Would you do that and strengthen him? Lord, we pray for Brother Pasley. In the name of Jesus. Lord, we ask you to touch Sister Pasley and to bless her and strengthen her, and Tom and Kristen in the church. And I pray that you would bring healing over his body right now in that hospital room where he is. Let there be strength and healing to flow to him in Jesus' name. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. My, there's a special touch of God here. Lay your hand on your neighbor, pray for him. I just pray that God would heal them, touch them, and strengthen them. Come on, everybody, all over. I want you to take a moment, pray. We pray for strength. We pray for healing. Go ahead, lift your voice. Come on, lift your voice. Pray with passion. Pray with fervency. In Jesus' name. Came to pass when they were gone over that Elijah said unto Elisha, "Ask what I shall do for thee before I be taken away from thee." And Elisha said, "I pray thee, let a double portion of thy spirit be upon me." Somebody say, "A double portion." Verse 11, and it came to pass as they still went on and talked, that behold, there appeared a chariot of fire and horses of fire, and parted them both asunder. And Elijah went up by a whirlwind into heaven. Isn't it amazing that Jezebel said she was going to kill him? How many ever read that? 1 Kings 19, verse 1 and 2. She sent a servant, said, "Go tell Elijah I'm going to kill him." The Lord said, "You know what? You said you're going to kill him. I just won't ever let him die." quit listening to the voices against your ministry and your family and your marriage and your future. Somebody shout, God's got this. Amen. I just won't ever let him die. Amen. Took him up in a whirlwind. Look what it says. Elijah went up by a whirlwind into heaven. And Elisha saw it. He cried, my father, the chariot of Israel and the horsemen thereof. And he saw him no more. And he took hold of his own clothes and rent them in two pieces. Verse 13, he took up also the mantle of Elijah that fell from him and went back and stood by the bank of Jordan. And he took the mantle of Elijah that fell from him. And he said, where is the Lord God of Elijah? I'd like to preach from the portion of scripture that I've read. I'd like to preach on the double portion mantle. The double portion mantle. If you are hungry for God and you want God to use you and work in your life, I want you to lift your hands and lift your voice and cry out to him and tell the Lord, I want the double portion mantle. I want it. I want the double portion mantle. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. In the name of Jesus. Praise the name of the Lord. Praise the name of the Lord. Amen. Turn to two or three people and tell them, I want the double portion mantle in my life. Amen. God bless you. You may be seated. There's such a powerful atmosphere here tonight. Can you say amen? He sat on this side of the church. He wasn't young by no means. He was in his elderly age, but you could guarantee every Monday through Friday before 6 a.m., Brother Curtis, he's going to be through the front door of that church and he's going to kneel right there and he's going to pray his hour. For years, he came and in the wintertime, he'd have his leather gloves on and his black coat and come in and he would sit there and if it was a little warm and he'd take those off and lay them, but you could definitely tell and see he was always there. I never remember a moment in early morning prayer that he was not there. I have to say that it was quite comforting as a pastor knowing that he was there. It was a strength to me as a pastor. Later in life, he got too feeble to come up the steps, but sat on the platform with us, but you can guarantee in prayer time he's going to be at that one spot every single day. Some of you probably heard me tell the story of the miracle of my third child, Jillian. She was about 29 weeks pregnant, and my wife wakes me up one night and she said, my water broke. You have to realize that's 2.5 months early. I'm the leeriest sleeper anyhow. I don't know about you, but I don't even know where I'm at when I get into a deep sleep. I don't even know who I am. She says, my water broke. I fell out of bed, literally. I fell out of the bed. I said, what? She said, my water broke. And so someone come to watch her kids, rush her to the hospital. Sure enough, her water had broken and the baby was on the way. And they rushed us to the Ohio State Medical Center for delivery because the local hospital says this baby's too much of a preemie, too early for us to have excellent care. You need to go there. And went there, and long story short, the baby was born, and it was a miraculous miracle. She had meconium in the womb, and it got into her lungs, and her lungs, which should be beating at a normal, very fast-paced infant rate, the lungs were sticking together. Walked into the NIC unit where she was and asked the doctor, how is she? You have a very, very, very sick little girl. Very, very ill. And I, uh, and And I said, well, she looks good. I had to look at her skin. Look at this. She said, I know we don't understand that while that's going on, but she's very, very, very sick. Her carbon dioxide level in her blood is 90%. Should be zero. Her oxygen level, which should be 100%, is 20%. Less than 20%. It should be 100%. She's very sick. And I said, but I don't understand it. She looks good. Her colors look good. And I looked at the monitor and said, the monitor's not saying that. She said, we think the monitor's broke. The nurse checked out of the NIC unit that day and went into the waiting room and stepped out at around 11 p.m. at night. And she checked out and she saw my mother sitting in the waiting room. She walks up to her and she says to her, are you Grandmother Bounds? And my mom said, yes, I am. She said, I just want you to know that that baby in that NIC unit is a medical miracle. She said, I'm not able to talk to you this way except when I'm checked out. But she said, I've already clocked out, so I'm going to tell you. She said, that baby, she said, we all knew the baby was going to die. As a matter of fact, one of the nurses already told my wife the baby's not going to live. She said, the baby was in such severe condition. Her levels in her blood were so bad. She said, I stepped out of the NIC unit, went to the restroom, knelt down. She said, I knelt down in the stall and began to pray. That's her story. She said, when I bent my knee praying for this baby that needed a miracle, she said, I felt God and knew somebody's already got a hold of God. She said, are you folks praying people? My mom said, yes, we are. Yes, we are. Amen. We are praying people. We believe that when you call upon the name of Jesus, something happens. We believe it doesn't matter what the doctor says. We know a great physician who's able to do exceeding abundantly above all that we can ask or think. I told the doctor, now that was the conversation going outside of the NIC unit. I was inside with the doctor, and I said, doctor, I don't understand it, but she looks good. The monitor looks good. Well, I think the monitor's broke. There's no way she could have improved this much. And I'll never forget when the respiratory therapist leaned her head through that door, and this is what she said. She said, I just want to tell you that that monitor's not broke. That baby's getting better. I said, well, how is that happening? They didn't think this could happen. And she said, I'm just going to go ahead and tell you, I've been here 18 years. There is no way possible that your baby can be doing what she's doing. But I'm going to tell you, I know the God of impossibility. I know a God that can step in when it seems like every hope has stepped out. I'm preaching to somebody in this room that God knows what you need. Amen. I'm glad to tell you she's 9 years old, Bible quizzing this weekend. I got to watch online her quiz in Newark, Delaware Invitational, and she quizzed out. That means she got as many as she can get right in one quiz. I'm a proud father, can you tell? But the doctor said that wasn't going to happen. But I'm going to tell you, whose report will you believe? I believe the report of the Lord. Amen. What did I tell that for? Because that man that sat right there at that, he later came after he found that my wife went into labor early and had the baby early. He came to me and he said, I have something I need to tell you. I said, what is it? He said, for one week, when I was praying before your baby was born, he said, every time I would start praying in the spirit, I would start begging for God to heal your baby and not let her die. Every day, he said, I would say, God, don't let that baby die. My wife, who was pregnant, knew nothing that was going on. The trauma that was in the womb, she didn't had any clue. But a man that was sensitive to God was praying for life when it appeared somehow in the unknown that there was death. There's something that is happening in the atmosphere, and we have to realize is that that man is now passed on, but who's going to take his place? Who's going to take his place? Who's going to step into that corner and begin to pray that hour every morning for the congregation? Who's going to be the one that's going to believe for the miracle when the report is hopelessness? Who's going to be the one that's going to be faithful? Saw something happen not too long ago I thought was very powerful. A man that came to our church, he came to our Easter service, and we have a community Easter celebration. He had come to that, seen it in the paper, and he had come. And later he meets me. He said, my son, he's in his 50s. He needs a miracle. I went to the rest home. This man is in his early 50s. I went to the rest home to see this man, and he had liver damage. He had liver damage. His liver had failed, and they had given him 3 to 6 months to live. And I walked in there to meet Kevin and to talk with Kevin. And when I get in there, and I said, Kevin, you know, we met before. You came to the Easter celebration, and tell me what's going on. He said, Pastor, they said I got 3 to 6 months to live, and I'm dying. There's nothing they can do. 4 specialists already looked at me and said, it's an impossibility. I'm going to get worse. And I said, what do you want God to do? He said, I want God to just let me live long enough to see my first grandbaby that's going to be born in 6 months. I said, we can pray for that. Let's ask God to help you. Well, I went to pray, and all of a sudden, I felt my help come in the room. I felt something coming in the room that was beyond just a prayer. And I began to talk to him about his soul. And I said, Kevin, have you repented? He said, I haven't repented. I said, you can get right with God. It doesn't matter the sins you've committed in your past. You can be right with God. You can make that right. He died on the cross for you. And I watched as he laid in that bed, sitting up in that hospital bed, in that nursing home, and tears were running down his face as he began to repent. I told Kevin, I said, now, you know what you need to do? You need to be baptized in Jesus' name, the only saving name. His eyes are yellow. His skin is yellow. And we prayed for God to touch him and be with him. He came to the church, and we baptized Kevin in Jesus' name. His 80-year-old father brought him, and his nephew brought him, and they came. They baptized him. I later asked, I said, how's Kevin doing? You know what the response was? He's better. They were taking 4 to 5 liters of fluid off of him because his liver wasn't working. But every time they would come to take the fluid off, it was getting less, less, less. He was being healed. He was improving. About the time that he should have been dead, they sent him home from the nursing home and said, we can't explain it, but there's nothing wrong with you. Yeah. Hallelujah. Somebody shout hallelujah. So I went and talked to Kevin. I said, tell me what happened. He said, preacher, I've been telling everybody they need to get baptized in that church because ever since I got baptized, he said, I got better. I want to tell you right now, it's not the water that's in the tank, but it's the blood that's in the Savior. He's able to do exceeding abundantly above all that you can ask or think. Amen. Oh, yeah. He said, as a matter of fact, they have scheduled me an appointment because the doctors want to study me because they said it's absolutely impossible for me to be healed, for me to be better. He said, they want to see what's going on. He went and saw the doctor. They run all the tests that they can do with all of their technology. And when they came back out, Brother Alex, they come in, and this is what the doctor said. He said, well, the only thing I can say is that you are a miracle. Watch. He said, I've only seen 3 in my life in my profession. One man had a tennis ball, a size tumor in his brain, and it was there on the scan, and all of a sudden it was gone. Somebody else, I don't remember what the other miracle was. He said, and you're the 3rd one that I've ever seen. He said, here's what we can't explain. Not only did you get better, but there's not one sign or one scar in your liver that there was ever cirrhosis in your liver. There's no evidence that you were ever sick. Can I tell you about the blood of Jesus? It will not only heal you and set a new path, it will remove the evidence that you were ever away from him in the world. There is a God that's great and greatly to be praised. Oh, if you believe it, clap your hands and shout amen. I come to preach to you tonight about not having church as usual, not just being a Christian in some religion. I come to preach to you tonight about having the power of God upon your life. Everywhere they went, there was miracles, there were signs, and there were wonders. I wonder how many people in this church would jump to your feet and say, I believe that God can give us miracles still in 2018. God can give us miracles. In this end time revival, this is what we're going to see. We're going to see teenagers lay hands on the sick and they recover. We're going to see ladies lay hands on people with cancer and it's going to be healed at merely mentioning the name of Jesus. Amen. How many believe it?
How many believe it? You're not too old to do something for God. Quit letting the devil tell you you're 60. You just got to let these young people do it. You're over 70. The young people are going to do it. No, you hear me, elder. There's something special about you. Psalms 92 said they will produce fruit in their old age. We need you praying. We need you at the church. We need you worshiping. Come on, young people. How many of you appreciate the elders in the church? We have a lady in our church, former pastor's wife in one of the churches. I looked one Sunday, and here she came. She just turned 90 the other day. It wasn't too long ago. She came down the aisle, and she was doing this. I can't dance like her. I'm trying to. I look silly up here trying to dance like a woman, don't I? I can't do it. Makes me feel manly when I say that, though, I have to say. She'd come down the aisle dancing. Down the aisle. Woo! That's how she does. Woo! She come down the aisle, and when she did, there was a cloud that came in that building that I could see visibly, because you've been through the fire, you've been through the valley, you came through the trial, and you know that you know that you know, if it had not been for the Lord on my side, I wouldn't be here. Come on, elder, we need you worshiping. Come on, if God can do it for Elijah, he can do it for us. If he can do it for Moses, he can do it for Joshua. Somebody shout amen. There's a restaurant back home. I don't know if it's in Canada. It's called the Golden Corral. I'm in the right place. My wife doesn't like it, so I don't get to go very often. She calls it the golden trough. But the last time I'd eaten there, that was the happiest meal I'd had in a long, long time. You can eat everything over and over and over again. You can leave there. One time I went to a Golden Corral and I looked and they had the steaks that were left out. And I had rare, which I don't know why anyone would want to eat a steak that's still alive. Medium rare. Medium. Medium well. And well done. And I remember thinking that, looking at all those steaks laid out there. You can just pick whatever you want. I thought, why is that one well done? Why is these this way? You know why that steak's well done? Because it's been through more fire than the rest of them. No wonder he's going to say to some of our seniors, well done. Thy good and faithful. There's an atmosphere in here that we feel right now, and it's not just because the young people are excited, but it's because the elders have been building an altar for years. They've been worshiping for years, and we honor that tonight. We have what we have because of the elders of the church. Come on, clap your hands and thank God for every faithful elder, for every grandmother and grandfather in the church. Amen. Joshua, don't come out of that Jordan River yet. You stay right there, Joshua. Tell those Levites to build an altar in the middle of the Jordan River. What are you saying? When Joshua became Moses' successor, God split the water, stopped the Jordan River from flowing. How many know that? Stop flowing. He did for Joshua what he had done for Moses. Joshua, under his leadership, all of Israel crossed into the promised land on dry ground. I mean, remember when Moses led all of those out of Egypt and they came across the Red Sea, everybody say on dry ground. Joshua gets ready to come out of there. He says, stop! I want you to build an altar memorial. Because this time I don't want them to forget what I've done for them. He said that way, when grandpa passes by with his grandkids, and the grandkids are passing by with grandbuddy, grandbuddy, Why are those stones sticking out of the water in the Jordan River? Have I never told you? God stopped the water from flowing. It was a miraculous. The river stopped flowing. Even when we got to the water and those Levites stepped out there with the Ark of the Covenant, there's a covenant that we had made with God that if we would follow his word, that he would do for us what no man could do for us. And I'm going to tell you, can I just be you for a minute? It makes me feel smart. Clara and Rosie, listen. What he did for me, he can do for you. Some 400 years later, Elijah says, Elijah, stay here. I'm going to go down the Jordan. Same place. Elijah said, no. Something happened to me. Something happened. Stay with me, Elisha, will you? Something happened with me. Because there was a moment. I need a coat. Brother Matt, can I use your mantle? Is there anything in your pockets? Is that okay? Because I gotta throw this around a little bit. I've been ruining some suit jackets during this youth convention. Turn around and face that direction. Here's the question I want to ask this congregation. Who is it that's going to get the double portion mantle? Who is it? I want you to face this way. Just face. Face right there. Yeah, look that way. Who's going to get it? Who's going to be used of God like that elder? That God would answer his prayer for me. Who is it that God's going to use that you can lay hands upon tumored bodies and the tumors disappear? I'm telling you, it's upon us. And Elijah was in a discouraged moment in his life. And the Lord said to that elder, get out of that cave. You don't belong in that cave. Get out of that cave. Something greater is going to happen ahead of you. And here's what I want you to do. I want you to go anoint Elisha, Hazael, and Jehu. Just because you're discouraged doesn't mean that my kingdom is over. Quit making decisions in low points and believe that God's greater than the moment. God's greater than this issue. God's greater than this trial. God's greater than this trouble. I just want to speak this and I'm going to move on. But I remember a few years ago, elders calling me, and I don't say this with any disrespect to any of the ministry, and you know my heart. I believe in our elders. But I kept getting phone calls like this. Where are the young preachers? We got so many licensed ministers in this age bracket, but under this age bracket, there's not very many. And where are the young preachers? What's going to happen to our future? What's going to happen to our churches? What's going to happen to the future of our churches? And there was like a fear that was coming upon our elder generation. And they began to do studies and small talks. And when I mean that, just small groups trying to encourage people to be anointed of the Lord. You know what they found out in the study? Is that there's more young preachers than that there's ever been. They just weren't licensed with the United Pentecostal Church yet. You hear me, Elijah? Can I tell some grandmother and some grandfather that's in this room, don't you be discouraged about this next generation? Because God told Elijah, I've got 7,000 that haven't bent their knee to Baal. I've got 7,000 that haven't kissed the carnality of this world. I feel like preaching to tell you there's a generation in this church that's rising up that loves God as much as you do. They love God as much as I do. They want to be used of the Lord. Stay there. Here's what I want you to do. If you believe it, shout amen. Amen. I am so impressed with what I see in our church right now, in this church right now. What I see in the kingdom right now, young people. Did you ever think you'd see 34,000 young people at Youth Congress? I believe it's going to get bigger. I believe it's going to be greater. How many believe that? Go anoint Elisha. He takes off. Elisha is working with the 12th yoke of oxen. I don't have time to go there, but he's working with the cattle. And you stay right there, face right there. You don't even know I'm coming. but I'm coming. I'm about to hit you. Glory. Sometimes preaching's a whole lot of fun. You know, you get to hit people and get by with it. He's facing that direction. You know what he's doing? He's taking care of his father's field. He is personally investing in his father's field. He's not thinking about himself. He's thinking about how he can better get the harvest for his father. He's not focused on him. He focused on what the father wants. He is self-denial to improve the father's business. Is it any wonder that Jesus said, I must be about my father's business? Young people, you got to get to a place where it's not about your agenda and what you want. This is about what does pastor want me to do? How can I get pastor's vision to pass? How can I be a blessing to my parents? How can I be a blessing? Somebody say amen. Amen. And Elijah just takes off walking. And this is sort of what he does. And he keeps on walking. Oh, yeah. You know what he does? He drops everything he's doing. Literally, the Bible says he ran after him. Come on. That's fast enough. He ran after him. And he said, let me do this. And I feel a witness right now. He said to the man of God, let me go home and tell my parents bye. He says, so I can go with you. Because when you smote me with that mantle, I felt something I've never felt in my life. And I want what you have. And he went, I feel a witness in the Holy Ghost. And I'm going to go kill the cow. And I'm going to burn the plow. I'm going to go kill the cow. I'm going to burn the plow. What I thought was going to be my future, I'm willing to sacrifice for the anointing of God. I'm willing to sacrifice for the will of God. I'm willing to sacrifice. Follow me. Come to tell you, God's looking for somebody tonight that will make a covenant with him that said, Lord, you're greater than my career. You're greater than my agenda. I want the anointing more than I want my will. I want your anointing more than I want the tradition of my family. If you call me to Haiti, I'll go. If you call me to Zimbabwe, I'll go. I'm preaching to somebody. If you'll call me to another country, I'll go. I never dreamt I would leave this land, but God, if you'll call me, I'll go. I'm preaching to somebody that's been on the edge. You feel a pulling of God, but you've got to make a covenant with God that you'll say, I'll go where you want me to go. I'll say what you want me to say. I'll be what you want me to be. I'll do what you want me to do. But God, all I want is your will. Is there anybody that feels that way tonight? I want your will. I'll lay the video games down if you want me to. I'll break up the girlfriend if you want me to. But God, I want to be anointed. I want the mantle of the prophet to rest on me. And he walks with him. He goes to Jordan. I'm trying to wrap this up tonight. But I felt like last night the Lord dealt with me about preaching about the mantle of a double portion. Everywhere Elijah went, Elisha went. And he goes down the Jordan River. And he comes down to where it was. And he says to him, you've been walking with me. You've been going where I'm going. You served me great. What can I do for you? Because everyone knew that he's going to be taken because the prophets and some of the prophets have been revealed. He's going to be taken by a whirlwind. What can I do for you? You know what he says? He says, I just want a double portion of your spirit. I want a double portion of your spirit. Now watch. This is his response. It's a hard thing. How many know that when Elisha was dead, somebody threw a dead body on his bones and he come alive? That was the double portion of the miracles. Twice as many as Elijah. Can I have just a couple more minutes? I'm lying. Maybe 5 minutes. Is that all right? I'm trying to be honest here. But hear me. When they threw that dead prophet's body, Elisha, or threw that dead man on his grave, that dead man jumped up. And it was twice as many miracles Elisha had as Elijah. But he was not saying to Elijah at this moment, I want a double portion of your miracles. He said, I want a double portion of your spirit. And I'm coming to a close. Please bear with me. This is what he was saying. It's a hard thing. Because to be a double portion means you have to be a representative as the firstborn son. What this means, have you ever heard of double portion? If you have 10 sons, you separate the inheritance 11 ways and you give the double portion to the oldest son. And the oldest son's responsibility as the firstborn was to fulfill his father's dream in his absence. He could not do his own thing. He could not follow his own path. He could not do whatever he wanted. He had to fulfill his father's dream. And when he said it's a double portion, he wasn't saying it's hard to have twice as many miracles as me. What he was saying was, your life's not going to be your own. That when I'm gone, you're going to be preaching what I preached. You're going to be sacrificing the way I sacrificed. And you're going to be fulfilling the call that God put upon me. Your life's not yours. But God sent me to you and placed a mantle around you that day. And you felt something that was more powerful than the success of a career. And you're saying today that, God, I want your will over my way. And the Lord has sent me to a Sunday night crowd to tell you, he's just waiting on somebody to make that type of covenant. Lord, I want your will over my way. And it's going to be you in the building that gets the double portion mantle. Those that will commit their life to God. I want you to lift your hands across this building. Come on, lift your hands. Lift your voices all over this building. Come on, lift your voice. The mantle. Hallelujah. 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 Come on, pray all over the building. I want the music to come, but I want you to pray. Come on, young people. Tonight I'm making a commitment. Tonight I'm making a covenant. Tonight I'm giving my life to the Lord. It's not going to be what I wanted. It's going to be what you want. Hallelujah. Come on, all over the building. I want some of you seniors beginning to pray right now. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I want God, you to use me. I want you to use me, God. Hallelujah. 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 I want those that are in the room that are 60 and older, I want you to come and line the front of the church, if you will. Also, I want the ministry, the pastoral staff, I want them to come. I want those that are 60 and older to come and stand the front of this church. Come on. Don't be ashamed of your age. 60 and older, I want you to come. If you don't feel like it, that's fine. I understand. I want you to come and stand here. I want you to face this direction. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Come on, clap your hands for them as they're coming. That's all right. Honor them. Go ahead. Come on back. Come on back. That's it. Lean back toward the altar area. You know why they're still here? Because at some point in their life, they felt the anointing of the mantle. And they made a covenant with God. Do you know where Elijah was taken up? Guess where Elijah was taken up? Elijah was taken up. You know where it was? Where Joshua built the altar of the stones of memorial. Study it. That's where it is. Some 400 plus years later, Elijah took him to Jordan. Where Joshua realized the God that was with Moses is with me. It was the same place when Elisha realized, if God could use Joshua after Moses, then he must be able to use me after Elijah. Everybody take your hands in the room. Put them like this. Jordan was the bridge between two generations. Tonight, something's going to cross over from them to these. If you want it, it's going to cross to you. There's going to be an anointing of God that's going to cross into this church. I have time to go into deep discussion. But when Matthew 3, John the Baptist said to the Jews, don't say you're the children of Abraham, for God is able of these stones to raise up children unto Abraham. It was at Bethabara. Some call it Bethabara. But it was here that John said, I must decrease so he can increase. It was a place in the Jordan of transition to where the next generation came and they got what this generation had. Hear me. I know your dad's in the ministry here and I love your family. But you remember I tell you this. You remember that I tell you this. All you young people. Elisha's mantle didn't fall on him. It fell near him. It's up to you. It's up to you to pick it up. It's up to you. And I tell you in the Holy Ghost that there's an unfinished work of prophecy. Because God told Elijah, go anoint Elisha, go anoint Hazael, and go anoint Jehu. But you can't find in Scripture where Elijah ever anointed Hazael or Jehu. You know who did it? He did. It was Elisha that did it. Elisha. It wasn't that Elijah was disobedient. Is that when God spoke a word about his purpose, it wasn't going to be fulfilled in one generation. It was going to be fulfilled through the next generation. And what God is going to do in this end time isn't bound to one age group. He's going to use everybody. He's going to use the old men dreaming dreams and the young men seeing it. Asked the question a few moments ago, who's going to get the double portion mantle? Who's going to get the anointing on your life? I'm not talking about churchgoers. Here's who it's going to be. It's going to be those that say, I'm going to live the way you've lived. I'm going to preach what you preached. I'm going to sacrifice the way you sacrificed. And I'm going to pray the way that you prayed. I'm going to be you in your absence. Is there any young people here that says, you know what, tonight I'm giving my life to the Lord? I'm not talking about speaking in tongues of repentance and baptism. I'm not talking about salvation. I'm talking about a new dimension of walking with God. How many of you believe that these young people are not too young to be used of the Lord? Would you say amen? Hallelujah! Here's what I'd like you to do. If you want God's mantle, the double portion mantle to be upon you, I want you to come and stand in front of some of these here tonight. Come on. If you want it. If you want it. Come on, young people. This is youth explosion. This is a new dimension. Come and stand. I realize some of you seniors, out of respect for me, if you feel weary in your body, do not feel you have to stay up here. I believe the point is made tonight. It's not one or the other. It's together. It's Moses and Joshua. It's Elijah and Elisha. It was John the Baptist preparing the way for Jesus. And tonight, there's a covenant that God wants you to make. I want you seniors to stretch your hands this direction over these young people. Would you do that? Stretch your hands over them. And I want you young people right now, I want you to start making a covenant. I choose your will over my way. All over this building, I want you to stretch your hands this way and pray for this group. There's an anointing for them. Hallelujah. Faithful. I'm going to be prayerful. I'm going to give sacrificially. In the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. Come on tonight. I surrender. You don't have to worry about the future. I'm going to be faithful to God.